So as you can see from the title of my talk, I want to share with you some of the experiences that we had in publishing the audio portion of the British National Corpus, which is not an oral history corpus, although you'll see it contains some oral history material. So I'll introduce that first. I'm going to talk about corpus dissemination and publication in general first, then I'll tell you a little bit about the British National Corpus and try and relate it to the interest of this meeting, and then I'll talk about how we address these three problems that anyone trying to use a corpus or publish a corpus has to get to grips with, and I'll hope that maybe our ideas about how to solve them may be of use to others. So the normal approach to corpus publication, of course, is that some institutional project collects a load of language material and prepares it, and then they want to make other people have access to it, so they submit it somewhere, a data center or a library or their own website. And in order to get it, sometimes, so typically you may have to log on, particularly if you want to download the corpus or get portions of it. There may be access restrictions for perfectly good reasons. There may even be fees. And then once you've got the material as a user, perhaps having gone through some of those hoops of registration and so on, you may find that it contains material that you may be looking for. This is a slightly problematic process in a number of ways. So first of all, just the effort of having to transfer your material to some other institution, it involves time and effort, and you may have to follow other people's rules about how they want the corpus to be prepared, and that you may not have, a lot of people find they don't have funding to support that sort of effort, and so the material is consequently not made as available as it could be. If you have to download the corpus in order to find what you're looking for, well, what does that mean? The whole thing, the whole corpus? In the past, for a relatively small corpora, that was perfectly feasible, or in the old days before downloading on the internet, you perhaps send off and obtain a copy of the corpus on a DVD or something. But for larger and larger corpora, that's just completely infeasible. And fees and passwords, well, you know, that is just a hassle. I mean, it's just an obstacle to helping people find what they want. And then if you go through that process in the conventional way, maybe it finds what you're looking for, or maybe it doesn't. You know, you can go through all this. And then even if it does, you've still got to find the material in your corpus, assuming it's in there somewhere. Okay, so a bit of background then. The audio portion of the British National Corpus is a fraction of, it's about one-tenth of the whole of the British National Corpus, which was originally collected as a text corpus. It was collected as a reference corpus of UK English in its variety of different uses, different contexts in the early 1990s. There's about 4,000 different text samples, of which 10% are essentially transcripts of different kinds of spoken material. And it has been freely available for a long time. The text, whether it was transcriptions of speech or markup of published text, was nicely marked up in TEI conformant XML, and it's available through a variety of different online portals. It has two parts. The spoken portion, let's say, is about 10% of the material. So it's about 10 million words of transcribed speech, and that's in two portions. A demographic survey portion, which is, for me as a linguist, perhaps the more interesting part in some ways. What happened was that a number of 124 volunteers were recruited across different regions and different localities and different ages and social groupings. So it's nicely sort of sampled, demographic sample of the UK population. And these people were loaned small Sony Walkman professionals and were asked to simply record conversations that were taking on around them, and they were given a log file, and they provided metadata about the people that they were talking with, and they agreed that they would obtain the permissions from the participants in the conversations, and also recorded information about the other participants and their relationship to the volunteer. That's the demographic part. But that obviously only reflects one type of spoken material. There are many other contexts apart from spontaneous conversations that are also natural and representative of normal speech. And so this demographic part was complemented by context governed part, which was more controlled collection of material. There were four broad areas of speech activity that were collected. As you'll see on the slide, I'm not just going to read them out, but you'll see that they include such things as religious sermons, political speeches, business meetings, doctor's appointments, some broadcast material. Mostly this is, although it's sort of, they're contextualized to a specific context, it's basically mostly spontaneous speech. It's people just talking in the way they would in these events. Some of it's a little bit scripted, but not very much. So they were recorded on compact cassettes. They were transcribed into ordinary English spelling by audio typists. The tapes were deposited in the National Sound Archive, like in a box. And then much more recently, many years later, we got a project with the British Library where they ended up to digitize all the tapes that remained. It's not all 10 million words of the transcribed speech. It turns out there's only about 7.5 million words on the recording, so there's some recordings missing. And then we anonymized the audio in a way that I'll explain in a moment. According to the original transcription protocols, the transcriptions were anonymized by blanking out surnames and phone numbers and other categories of personal information. So it was done quite systematically. And we had to anonymize the audio similarly by replacing those portions with silence before they could be published on the same terms as had been agreed with the original volunteers. Okay, so that's the material that I'm talking about. And you'll see it's not intended to be used by any particular type of researcher. So Jakob was talking yesterday about the two different senses of oral history, as a material but also as the process of analysis. And here we're really just presenting material that can be used for all sorts of different types of research and processes of research, different methodologies. Our job is just to make it available to people. So these are the first kind of problems that one encounters if you want to find stuff that you may be interested in a large collection of material, particularly audio material. How does a researcher find things? How do we as corpus providers make it easier for people to search and browse and find the things they want? And how do we make the audio available to the world in the first place? So I was thinking about what's in the interests of people in this group may have, and also what makes material of the kind we've been looking at, oral history material, and interesting to linguists. I mean, although this is collected for a variety of purpose, as a linguist I'm interested in this because all this material, whether it's whatever kind of material is, for me it's just exemplifying different types of spoken English usage, and I'm interested in English speech. From a linguistic perspective, or perhaps a dialectological perspective, one of the things that we're often interested in is just finding unique and interesting words and expressions. That's one of the values of looking at vernacular speech. It's a common interest, actually, not only amongst academics, but in the general population. But we're also interested in not just unique and specific things, but also regular differences, so features of speech or pronunciation which are specific to a particular dialect. But, you know, and you want them to be repeated, so you perhaps would want to find multiple instances of pronunciations of a particular vowel or word or usages of a particular expression. So we're interested in both of these things, the unique but also the repeated instances of a particular phenomenon. So the first of these things is a bit like finding a needle in a haystack, particularly when you've got, you know, an 8 million word corpus to search. And actually finding regular differences is also like finding multiple needles in haystacks, and that's not an easy task. So there's a contrast between searching in audio versus searching in text. Searching in text is easy, and all this material has been transcribed, so you can find which document might contain words that you're interested in, for instance, by searching the transcriptions, and then from there move to the audio. Although not everything you're necessarily interested in is going to be reflected in an orthographic transcription. So if you were just focusing on the audio and you wanted to find something, a particular word or a particular phrase or a particular sound, and you just sort of started listening to the corpus, if you just started playing the tapes and listening to them, which is the conventional methodology in a lot of language research spoken at you, people just listen to the tapes and find instances of the things you might be interested in. Well, let's suppose you're interested in a particular phoneme. Zh is the least frequent phoneme of all the phonemes in English. And in order to find the first token in the BNC, 13 minutes in, and there you go, there's one. Okay? The thousandth most frequent word, so a relatively high frequency word, twice, you'd have to wait 14 minutes. What about expressions? A word pair from the is the most frequent word pair in the study that we were working on at the time of this project. And you find the first instance in 17 minutes. Railways, the 10,000th mark, you'd have to go through 26 hours of material to find one instance of the word railways. Getting paid, for instance, that was one of the least frequent word pair in the phonological study we were looking at. You'd have to listen for 95 hours to find the first instance. To get 10 tokens, of course, it's even worse. So for railways, you'd have to listen to get 10 tokens, 41 days and nights without sleep or rest breaks or anything. So just listening and waiting for stuff is not a feasible way to access and search for things in spoken language corpora. So to be useful, we need to index them at the word and segment level. And actually, Martin, did we start bang on 15:15 or are we going to?
No, 20 past.
Okay, because I'm running behind time. Okay, thank you. So we use the forced aligner, and Joe Pruvall is going to talk more about it. It's been mentioned before. Joe's going to talk about how that works and a bit more about that in the following talk. So we just use the forced aligner to associate every word and via that every segment, every consonant and vowel in the corpus with their start and end points in the sound file, so relating the transcriptions to the objects in the audio. So there are obviously different pronunciation differences between pronunciations of words in different dialects and also different contexts. People pronounce things a little bit different. So some pronunciation details are dealt with by having different phonetic transcriptions in the lexicon that the aligner uses. Other variations are used by the fact that the acoustic models of the aligner allow for a lot of variation. They're probabilistic models, but I won't talk too much about that. So as a consequence of forced alignment, what you end up with is alongside the a portion of the audio, we've got a word by word start and end points for every word, and also for every vowel and consonant. This is how they're rendered. The data is actually just a long text file that I'll talk more about in a moment. Forced alignment isn't perfect. There are all sorts of problems that make it problematic, particularly for material recorded under less than studio conditions, as it were. And these do cause problems. And so a common question that people ask is, well, how well does it work? So we tested that in a pilot study and then in the bigger phonetic study that we worked on much later on. And the rough figures are these. So essentially, forced alignment either works well, or it's rubbish. It's a very binary die. So when it works well, the alignment accuracy of word edges is generally very good. That's within, 60% of material in our well-aligned material was within 50 milliseconds, and 80% was within 100 milliseconds. That's very good for finding stuff. We released almost all of the aligned audio BNC online. All the stuff that we could successfully anonymize was released online, and we just exposed. So in two ways, the first URL here is the web page, phonox.org/audio-BNC. It will take you to a description of the material and also give you links to get into the data. The data itself is exposed on the internet at this second URI, bnc.phonox.org. That's where the data is. The data includes all the WAV audio files from the anonymized recordings, the text grid alignments from the forced aligner, HTML transcriptions, as well as a bunch of files that we generated, which are just big ASCII files containing the words and the sounds and their time stamps, their start and end times. So, second problem is getting hold of stuff. When the data gets quite large, the problem of just either reading material or copying it from one site to another becomes fairly large. Obviously, if you're on site and you've got a hard drive, copying, say, a terabyte of data, you know, it takes a little bit of time. To download it can take a lot longer. And as corpora get larger and larger, this is going to be more and more of an issue. You shouldn't need to have to download the whole thing in order to find the material you want. If you want to download the whole thing, I'm a great believer you should be able to download the whole thing, because it depends on the kind of work you're doing, providing you're willing to take as long as it takes to get a hold of it. We don't prevent people from downloading as much or as little of our material as they wish. But if you're not going to download it, we want to help people work out how to browse the data, how to search for things they want, how to save it, how to link to clips without necessarily having to download and save them. So I mentioned already that we compiled for our own research and data organization purpose massive indices. So this is an example of a small portion of the Word index. So we have, it's just a multi-column format. We've got the transcribed words. The example I played earlier had this dialect word gadji, which is from Tinker's Cant, traveling people's speech in Scotland in this oral history interview. Gadji occurs 4 times in the entire database. There's a start time and end time for that segment of recording, and the file name of the alignment file from which where this data is stored. And that kind of simple data format, and this is just a tiny fragment, there are 8 million more lines in this file. This sort of simple format is easily converted to W3C compliant syntax for audio fragments. So we have the word, and here we have basically a long URI, which I'll explain a bit more in a moment. So essentially our site, and then the file name, and then a start time and end time, just written in the HTML5 syntax for audio fragments. And that's one thing I want to advertise and push and advocate in the use of audio corpora more generally. Using that syntax for referring to and addressing audio segments of whatever size, it's possible, since any modern browser understands that HTML5 syntax for fragments, you can just paste it into your into the URL bar and get that portion of file streamed to your computer. It required on our side, on the server side, a little bit of technology to be able to interpret those requests and serve snippets of audio like that, for which I am thankful to my IT guy, John Pybus, who did that for us. But it's not a huge job, and it's a known technology, and if people needed help with that, we'd always be happy to help set things up on the server side to do that. So essentially with the index, and this method of this syntax, you can refer to any word in the corpus. You can refer to any sound in the corpus and get multiple instances of it, and do what you will with them, listen to them or download them. Since you don't have to use a web browser, of course, to refer to URIs, you can use, say, a wget command on the command line and download whatever material you might want to. It also means that other people can, because our data is openly exposed, other people can link to it and publish it. And so here's an example, here's a snapshot from the University of Lancaster BNC web service, which is, they've had for a long time, and this is a typical kind of corpus search tool in which you can type in words or sequences of words or regular expressions for queries that you might be interested in getting, and you can specify other things. They've had this running at Lancaster for a long time as a way of searching the text corpus. But when we exposed our data, the developer of this tool was easily able to add audio as an add-on, a feature, so you can now specify what type of material you want, whether you want speech only or text only or both. So you can type in a query, say, Chappens, that's another of these Tinker's Cant dialect words from that oral history snippet I put up earlier, and that will return, there's two instances of it in the entire corpus, and then you could, you can click on the audio icon, and that will play the audio, but also give you options for saving either the entire sentence in which it occurs, or just the word with plus or minus 10 seconds. It's still 10 milliseconds. It's still under development. You're welcome to try it out. If you do use it, there's also a feedback box on there that you can simply click a button to say how well it was aligned. Did you find what you were looking for? Okay. So that's how we can search and look for material which is indexed. But it's also important to be able to various researchers to be able to get hold of media fragments that aren't indexed. So I've got a couple of examples of the kind of thing. So lots of non-speech activity on such recordings. This first example is a sigh. It's just someone going, and then there's pauses either side. And so if you're interested in, people are interested in interaction in language use, so maybe interested in that. People are interested in motion or other kinds. There's many interesting reasons why you might be interested in a sigh. Or in-breath and out-breath, or coughs, or other material that's either difficult or perhaps impossible to transcribe. I've got one example of a teenager imitating a dog being sick, and there's no transcription conventions for that I know of. Some material for which we have the audio, but it actually wasn't transcribed. The audio typists didn't transcribe everything. Some of it's a little bit quiet or a little bit hard to work out, hear what people are saying, and so I think they were working to a very tight time schedule, and so there's some material they just left out, and we only know that they left it out now that we've got the audio, but of course someone else could transcribe that in future, but you wouldn't be able to transcribe it unless you had access to it. So we very much believe in making all of the material openly available, not just the material that is indexed and that you could search for. Having a search interface, web interface for search is great, but it should not be the only way you've got to access the material, because otherwise you're completely restricted by the design requirements of the people publishing the data in the first place. And we don't want to do that. We don't want to restrict people in that way. Okay, I'm just going to quickly finish up sharing stuff. Well, some of that I've already more or less covered, the fact that if you've got material that's openly available, you can federate searches across different, we can have multiple sites searching the same material, but also you could also have one site that searches across multiple sites that are exposed in this way. In order for that to work, that idea of a federation, I'm quite keen on this idea of having data of this sort that's published across lots of sites in order to have federated search across many sites, and I suppose that in many respects is very much the spirit of Clarin. That's great. We need to agree and follow some data standards in order to make that possible. Open access is an important part of that. Markup is a bit of an issue with spoken language corpora. This figure that I've adapted from a paper by Schmidt, a very perceptive paper, lists a number of different spoken language corpora and the file formats in which the markup is made available and the transcription conventions that they follow. These are all, in a sense, they're all following well-established conventions for marking up, but they're all following different ones. And it's almost every, even some people sometimes say, well, you should use, TEI conformant XML. Yeah, but even that's a very open-ended, flexible annotation system, so it's not always clear to me. Having too highly articulated theory about how the material should be marked up can be helpful, but it can be also unhelpful, really, in helping to find stuff. There again, there are some good proposals. So here's another party that has been using our data to add markup to the BNC, the existing markup for BNC, by adding little indices, little tag, tags for audio files and portions of audio files for particular words. Again, using our start time, end time syntax in XML, it's fairly easy to do in a fairly light touch way. It doesn't expand the size of the XML data structures very, very much, really. Okay, so yeah, finally, this is very much in the spirit of linked data, I suppose. We're not necessarily, so these are the Berners-Lee's principles for linked data, and I think what the approach we're taking follows these mostly. So yeah, we have URIs for identifying the resources, the words and phonemes, but they're just time portions, they're just time intervals. We're not restricting, as I said before, to any particular type of linguistic object there. Yeah, the object, the URIs are dereferenceable. You can look them up, that's fine. We don't really have links between our audio clip references and other data, metadata, but that would be probably a good way to go, to build links across corpora. We could talk, I think it'd be interesting to talk more about that later in the day. So these are some principles, or at least very good ideas about how we can add value to corpora of this sort. So I've kind of been drawing a contrast between the old model of you have all your data in a central place with a central catalogue and the users are very distributed, versus the sort of more, the contemporary, more, I suppose, sort of cloud-based approach where you have distributed user base, but the data is also distributed across multiple sites. But in order to find stuff, what the users do need is some sort of central catalogues or indices to enable them to access the data which is distributed across different types. That means that, on the payment side, rather than having subscribers pay for access to corpora in the old way, I think it's preferable if the providers of the data take on the obligation to finance the stuff through grants or whatever. Okay, so data centers still continue to have a very important role in this sort of shift in how people use audio corpora or linguistic corpora, but it changes a little bit from, in my view, it is shifting from question of centralizing the data itself to centralizing the data about the data that enables you to get hold of what you want. That's it, I think. Thank you very much. Okay.